Good morning and good day. Thank you to each and every one of you for being here with us today. My name is Joanna Poon, Head of Discipline, Built Environment at the University of Derby. Today marks CIOB's very first Global Academic Summit, and I am delighted to be able to welcome you all today. Before we get started, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to all of you who make time to attend the CIOB Academic Summit 2023. Today wouldn't have been possible without you. The CIOB Academic Summit is a unique conference dedicated to our global academic community. This summit is aimed at leading the way to transform our academics, connect ability on a global scale, leading the way for cross-collaboration, sharing of cutting-edge research, knowledge, and education, and most importantly, building of a strong sense of community. Well, I don't want to take up too much of your time. I need to leave some time for our guests, contributors, and I certainly will be today will be fun and full of learning. So a warm welcome to each of you. If you have any questions, suggestions, clarifications, or just want to say hi, please do so on our chat box. I would now like to call upon our very first guest contributor, Dr. Konstantinos Papadikis. Dr. Konstantinos Papadikis holds a BEng in Mechanical Engineering from Aston University and an MSc in Advanced Mechanical Engineering from the University of Warwick in the UK. He continued his studies in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at Aston University in the UK, where he received his PhD. He later worked as a postdoctorate research associate in the Energy Technology Group at the University of Southampton. Dr. Papadikis joined the Department of Civil Engineering at Xi’an, Jiaotong-Liverpool University as a lecturer in fluid mechanics and hydronics. He was appointed as the head of department between 2017 to 2020 and is currently the Dean of Design Schools comprising the Departments of Architecture and Design, Civil Engineering and Urban Planning and Design. His research has been published in some of the leading journals in environment, environmental, chemical, and agriculture engineering fields. For the impact of his initial work in thermochemical conversion of biomass, he has been awarded the 2011 UK Scopus Young Researcher Award in the field of engineering, Elsevier in association with the UK-US Bright Commission Royal Society, London. Dr. Konstantinos Papadikis' presentation will focus on digital transformation and information management in post-COVID education era. Again, have your question at ready, submit them in the comment tab on the screen. Welcome, Dr. Konstantinos Papadikis.
Thank you very much, Joanna. Thank you very much for inviting me in this academic summit. It's really a pleasure, and I hope that the audience, generally the participants, will find the presentation interesting, and perhaps, you know, we can open, you know, dialogue, let's say, on how to improve the education in this new era, if you like, of education that definitely the COVID pandemic has accelerated, and I think we have all witnessed to a certain extent, let's say, some of us to a greater degree, some others perhaps in a lower degree, but nobody has been left unaffected from this. Please let me share my screen for, I hope everyone can see my screen. So, John, as you mentioned, I'm going to be talking basically about this accelerated, if you like, move to digital education, let's say, and basically this presentation is going to be primarily a self-reflection on what I have actually observed, what has gone bad, what has gone right, let's say, over this period of the COVID pandemic, and how the access to information, let's say, has affected, improved, or perhaps not so much improved the way we deliver our curriculum and the way we educate our students. But first, before I go into the main dish, let's say, of this presentation, I would just like to introduce a little bit where I'm coming from. As Joanna just described, I'm currently the Dean of the Design School in Xi'an, Jiaotong-Liverpool University, what we call as XJTLU. XJTLU was established back in 2006, so we have a very, let's say, short history in comparison to some of the European institutions or some of the institutions around the world. However, we are expanding pretty fast. At this moment, we have approximately 25,000 students, and we aim over the next few years to actually increase this intake to and reach approximately 35,000 students. The two main campuses of the universities are located in Suzhou, and in Suzhou campus, what we call the SIP campus, the Suzhou Industrial Park campus, as well as the campus in Taizang, which is fully, let's say, dedicated to what we call integrative education. And I'm going to talk a little bit about this later on. However, the university is further expanding also in the Great Bay Area with additional schools and academies. So this brings basically the overall number of students standing in our institution to approximately 35 to 40,000 students. So although we are very young, we are expanding pretty fast, and I believe it's a very interesting, actually, place to be. And for those that they don't know, basically, the Xi'an Jiaotong-Liverpool University is a joint venture between Xi'an Jiaotong University in China and the University of Liverpool in UK. Our students receive a dual degree, one from the Chinese Ministry of Education and one from the University of Liverpool in UK for the undergraduate programs, whereas for the postgraduate programs, we purely follow the postgraduate model, if you like, of the University of Liverpool. We are hoping to be able to award Chinese degrees also at the postgraduate level, but at the moment the university is pretty young actually to achieve something like that. So for postgraduate taught and postgraduate research education, we currently award degrees from the University of Liverpool in UK. XJTLU is unique in many aspects, and its main vision, basically, and mission, its main, if you like, core for its establishment is basically to bridge and bring together, if you like, the best Western practice and best Eastern practice. So when we actually join the two, we end up with a unique, basically, education model with many challenges, actually, when it comes to basically blending together different educational philosophies and different educational ideologies. But it's always exciting actually to be part of such an initiative, because it really opens up the mind of all academics that are actually involved, let's say, in the process. So XJTLU also wants to further explore, let's say, new management style of the educational establishments, and also to interlink, if you like, research and education for the benefit of the society, for the benefit of the public. So XJTLU aims to impact, let's say, the education, not only in China, to bring a new educational model for the Chinese, basically, institution, but also to have a global impact of how education should be approached, in other words, in the 21st century, in the century, in other words, of digitalization, in the century of artificial intelligence, in a century basically dominated and driven by data and most likely machines in the near future. So, going back to what I represent here, the Design School. The Design School basically envisages to become a leading unit in the provision of interdisciplinary and international design education, not only in China, but also beyond the borders of China. And how do we do that? And you will probably see where this comes from a little bit later on. We were actually planning to do it through the amalgamation, in other words, by joining, by bringing together, in other words, design knowledge and art coupled with technical and management education. considering the number of disciplines that the design school actually represents. As it was introduced earlier by Joanna, we have quite a lot of diversity. We deliver degrees, for example, in pure engineering, like civil engineering and architectural engineering, but also we are looking at design from a more artistic form, in more artistic expressions, as they express, for example, through architecture and industrial design, but also at the bigger scale, the city scale, as it is expressed by the urban planning and design discipline. So how can we actually do this? Okay, so basically we understood in the early days of the establishment of the academic unit as a design school, because it's a relatively young unit. We are in full operation from basically September 2020, although the departments constituting this specific school have been in existence from the early days of the university. So it was a bit challenging actually to bring those disciplines together in a new form and actually making them work collaboratively and creatively in this new direction and in this new vision that we actually established, in a sense. So how do we achieve that? We realize that we have to be creative. We realize that we have to be innovative. We realize that we need to be disruptive in our thinking. And how can we do that? Actually, we realize that we need to bring the boundaries between different disciplines and develop what we call an integrative, if you like, learning ecosystem. An ecosystem basically that brings the students from different disciplines together in the exploration of different aspects of design related to more specific, if you like, structural design, but how this will impact basically the general city planning, the sustainability, for example, of the whole system and so on. So these are some of the core ideas that they were previously missing when the disciplines were derived at its pure form. For example, civil engineering was focused more, I would say almost exclusively in purely, for example, on its engineering form, with what sustainability or sustainable design would mean for an engineer would be something slightly, or in many cases, completely different of what sustainable design would mean from an urban planner. So in a way, we needed to come up with creative and innovative ideas to ensure that our students, regardless of the disciplines that they follow, become active members of this, if you like, integrative learning ecosystem that will be driven basically by research-led learning and teaching, syntegrative education. So in other words, integrating, in other words, the input received from our industrial partners and our industrial advisory board into our curricular or extracurricular activities, and also to inspire, if you like, entrepreneurial and leadership skills development through a wide range of cross-discipline activities and cross-discipline learning within the school. So it was something really challenging, and I was really happy, actually. I'm still really happy because I still hold the position of the dean of the design school, to be the first dean of the school that had the chance actually to look at things basically and how education is delivered to our students from a different perspective. The core ideas, okay, for our future education was based at the system level. We need to make sure that our students understand how different systems work and not only be narrow-minded, focused, let's say, on pure disciplinary education delivered through the degree program, to actively incorporate concepts of sustainability, to bring into live existence, if you like, the digital forms of communication, to incorporate artificial intelligence and data analytics into the program, and also to with the aim actually of developing this complexity, if you like, mindset that the future engineers, designers, and planners will need to possess in the 21st century. So this was basically done in order for students basically to understand what are the interlinkages between earth, for example, and climate, the city and the community, how heritage, for example, preservation benefits the society, and how the society, for example, is expressed through through the heritage, in other words, and how the humans basically interact with the natural world. So, and only under these conditions, we realized that our students would be able to provide smart solutions, integrated smart design solutions for future societies. Okay, so this was basically something to provide you a little bit of a context, basically, on how we operate, on what we are actually planning to do, because then everything else, when we talk about the impact of COVID-19, basically, in the delivery of education, becomes relevant to what the school's future aims and achievements actually aim to be. In terms of for the school composition, just to talk a little bit about the school itself. As Joanna mentioned, the school basically comprises four departments: architecture, civil engineering, industrial design, and urban planning and design. So we have approximately 100 full-time staff, but we also have a great team, basically, of part-time staff, primarily practitioners, to support specifically design classes or studio-based modules, and so on. And currently, we are delivering 5 undergraduate programs and 8 postgraduate programs, some of them in full-time and some of them in part-time mode. And we also award PhD degrees in the 4 main areas that basically the departments represent. In addition to that, we also provide, we collaborate with the Academy of Future Education in XATLU to co-deliver and award what we call integrative education degree programs. And for example, the one that the design school very actively participates is the industry and enterprise tailored education program, which is heavily linked with the industry in the built environment sector. And it's basically co-delivered in a sense with our industrial partners. And we specifically focus in the core thematic area of urbanization. In addition to that, we also provide preparatory courses for RIBA membership for our students, as well as for active professionals in the field. Most of our students typically pursue postgraduate, undergraduate students pursue postgraduate education, and you can see more or less that our students become accepted in postgraduate programs in some of the top institutions in the world, in US, in Europe, Australia, and so on. So this primarily constitutes approximately 90% of our students. They would go, actually, they would move into further studies. But we also have a small percentage of students that would move directly from their undergraduate program seeking direct employment from in many cases, our industrial partners or very reputable industries in the fields of engineering, construction management, architectural design, and so on. This is just an example. Our industrial partners and our alumni actually spans a wide range of industries, basically, and professions and companies, but they have actually accepted them in their teams. Okay, so this is more or less a little bit of background on the design school in XATLU and XATLU itself. So I would just like to focus a little bit on today's topic. So as you all know, the whole world has been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. And maybe all of you know that since we are located in China, China only very recently relaxed its policy on COVID-19. So there was a very strict, if you like, handling of the pandemic, which resulted in many cases of shifts from on-site to online and from online to on-site education at different moments in time. So this gave me an opportunity, actually, as an academic, to observe how our students respond and how our students react to such shocks in their learning, if you like, habits, or if you like, learning culture or learning attitude, and so on. So going back to our design school learning and teaching strategy, or if you like, learning and teaching philosophy, there are different sets of skills, or if you like, different types of qualities or attributes that we would expect our students to develop during throughout the course of the studies. So the graduate attributes, I guess they are in line with what most of the universities around the world are basically aiming to do. We want our students to be global citizens. We like them to be problem solvers. We want them to be system thinkers, basically to possess basically all of those qualities that would make them be, let's say, easily in a way assimilated in industrial, if you like, environments all around the world, and to be culturally, if you like, sensitive and also industry ready, let's say, to and also to possess this self, if you like, discipline qualities that will make them attractive, let's say, for the future employers. So how basically do we do that? We develop certain skills of students, which in this particular slide I categorized in three major categories, like disciplinary skills, in other words, skills related directly to the discipline. For example, engineering design skills, for example, mathematical skills, oral communication skills, and so on. So basically all of these skills that come as, if you like, a complete package with a degree program. But in addition to that, there are also general skills that we aim to develop through the delivery of the program, and also some that in this particular slide I call future skills, skills that have not become, if you like, an integrated part of the modern, let's say, curriculum development and delivery, but something that would be extremely useful and also that will transform, in other words, our student community, let's say, into a more resilient, if you like, a more complete, in other words, personalities and professionals, and will be able to, embed, if you like, this kind of flexibility, and to be able to react more and to be able to absorb basically shocks that they are going to experience throughout their professional career. So it's the right part, in other words, of this particular graph that is more of the focus, if you like, of this study that I would like to present to you today, which primarily it's going to affect on how and basically provide some, if you like, a picture of how our students reacted in a way to these shocks, or if you like, transitions from on-site to online and from online to on-site learning and so on. Why would I call this as a shock? Because it is completely different for a student. The experience of a student is completely different when a specific module or a specific program is delivered basically on site, and the type of interaction that this student will actually have with the academics themselves, as well as with their peers inside the class. Whereas when a particular course is moved to an online mode, there is a higher and increasingly higher degree of learning autonomy, basically, that the student needs to actually show in order to be able to perform, in order to be able to perform in the same level, in other words, as the student would in a non-site delivery setting. So for this particular study, and over the course of the last 3 years, I chose three different types of modules, 6 modules in total, primarily from the degree programs of civil engineering and architecture. And I went through, some kind of data collection through our virtual learning platforms in the university, and try to more or less create an idea, okay, an impression in my mind on how students basically perceive or react, if you like, to those shocks, if you like, in their learning culture. So the three different types of modules, two of them were primarily theoretical. By a theoretical module, I mean a module that is primarily lecture-based, so materials that can be delivered in the class in the form of a lecture. And typically students attend a certain number of lab classes or practical classes, and they are primarily assessed at the end of the semester through an examination. So in other words, the student accumulates knowledge throughout the semester with interim, if you like, assessment components, typically of low percentage weighting. So, but the primary, let's say, mark, or if you like, the primary performance, if you like, of the student is indicated by the final examination or the final coursework, if the module has a its coursework assessed module. Whereas when it comes to engineering project-based modules, these are modules that the theoretical knowledge is being applied in the design of some kind of structure. Okay, and these are the two civil engineering modules, because civil engineering is the core, if you like, engineering program within the school's overall curriculum. And also studio-based module, where they have this kind of unique, let's say, nature, where a conceptual, if you like, idea is being refined through a continuous interaction, basically, with a corresponding tutor that leads basically the project. And then it typically ends with some kind of physical or digital, if you like, model development. So in other words, the reason I categorize those these types of modules and I separate them is because the learning experience is completely different. And I was really interested actually in seeing how the students respond to the different types of modules, because there are different components, if you like, different skills basically associated with those. For example, when it comes to a theoretical module, problem solving skills, for example, or mathematical skills play the most important role. But when it comes, for example, to engineering project-based modules or studio-based modules, there are additional components, additional skills like team working, for example, critical thinking, and all of these different, let's say, more general, if you like, skills, communication skills that come basically into the picture. So I thought that these three different types of modules will actually provide a relatively rough idea of how the students basically perceived, if you like, or how the students basically responded and reacted to these transitions between online and on-site learning. Now, if we look into some of those details, and I just want to draw your attention in a couple of columns basically here. I just want to let everyone know what this academic year 1920, 2021, 2122 actually means. So basically, when you're looking at the column on the data on the academic year 1920, this is a semester two of that academic year in the Northern Hemisphere, and it's basically the first semester that we moved basically in a purely online delivery mode without any expectation. The COVID-19 pandemic basically was in a way the restrictions, if you like, the global, if you like, traveling restrictions and accessibility, if you like, of spaces were very heavily restricted during that particular period from March 1920 all the way to August 1920. So that particular semester was purely moved online, whereas for semester two of academic year 2021, and with the restrictions that were placed, especially in China, because I'm talking about now the Chinese context, basically it was a purely on-site delivery. And then during the second semester of the academic year 21-22, some of you might remember the lockdowns, for example, in Shanghai, and that generally in China there was very strict control of the pandemic spread. So again, in other words, the delivery went to an online mode. So what you actually see between 1920, 2021, 2022 is basically an online, on-site, and online delivery, back to online again. So two online, and in the middle, it's the on-site delivery. And if I could just summarize basically what you actually can see here, is that theoretical modules, okay, the ones that were primarily focused on structures and fluid mechanics and so on, typically displayed an equal or even better performance than they used to when they were delivered on-site. And those can be, this can be attributed to several parameters. Why? Because the majority of the lectures were recorded. Students had the luxury, in other words, to watch the material again and again, to access it at their own time, at the time that they were basically learning better, okay, or at the time perhaps that they were more energetic, in other words, to engage with the content and so on. So generally, if one basically combines all of these different metrics, and we're talking about the module averages achieved, the failure rates after the first sit of the exam, the attendance rate, but the attendance here is a very vague term. I will talk a little bit about it later on. The standard deviation achieved on that module, it's basically the average standard deviation in the class, and as well as the coursework late submissions or non-submission tools, which are primarily performance, if you like, metrics, as well as engagement with the module content metrics. So what someone can see is that the theoretical modules have actually, as I mentioned, showed equal or in some cases even better performance than when they were delivered on site. And this could be attributed basically in the way that the content was delivered and the content was, let's say, accessed at different times, something that is not really possible when a particular program is delivered in a purely on-site mode. Of course, most of the universities have shifted to a hybrid delivery mode, so an on-site content is being recorded and also becomes available into the virtual learning platforms of the university. But this is, I would say, somewhat a more recent trend rather than the norm as it used to be before the COVID-19 pandemic. Also, I will make a few comments later on the self-reflection, if you like, slide about what is also the impact, however, on this increased, if you like, learning autonomy on theoretical modules for students. If one, however, looks at project-based modules, and these are modules and studio-based modules, and these are modules where team working and practical skills and applied basically skills come together, you will see actually that the performance is primarily declining when it comes to an online delivery in comparison to an on-site delivery. This is perhaps even more evident if someone looks at the module average, for example, chart with the two engineering project-based modules, that you will see an increased performance, average level performance in the academic year 2021, okay, where the module was delivered on site. And this, of course, okay, has its roots primarily on the increased level of interaction between the students, as well as the continuous interaction with the academic in the class, working over specific projects, analyzing different problems that they might encounter, and so on. This was more or less the picture for studio-based modules, where one of the major changes was that all physical model making in the architectural discipline was basically moved to digital model making when the module was delivered online. So this had a tremendous, actually, impact on the not only on the performance of the students, but also on the level of output that was actually presented. So this is something that we have discussed quite extensively in the management team meeting in the school, on how basically to make our students more digitally literate, because students were basically asked to use any type of software for digital model making, and through additional tutorial provision, but on the virtual space, on the online space, something that required highly disciplined, let's say, approach to learning, and of course, high interest, in other words, on the program that is being studied. So this, I think, during that period, and by roughly looking of how the students reacted and performed in different types of modules, I think that gave us quite actually a food for thought, if you like, at the university level, on how to improve or how to take into consideration and into the picture all of these different aspects that needed to be developed for our students to be able basically to respond, let's say, to sudden changes or what I call basically shocks in their learning culture, in their learning style, and so on. However, if one just simply looks on those particular charts, someone can find the information a little bit misleading, because these are basically data that collected for different modules after the module has been completed. Okay, so it does not basically represent a dynamic, if you like, evolution of the student engagement, if you like, with the module content and so on. When someone looks into the details, and unfortunately it was very difficult actually to visualize and collect this kind of data, but I can simply present it as a matter of a self-reflection, if you like, and some thoughts just by simply monitoring, if you like, on a weekly or in some cases even daily basis of how the students actually engaged with the content when that was delivered online. So obviously, the lack of access, being in an online setting, students have complete lack of access to critical facilities, labs, workshops, studios, for example, and they are asked, basically, they are forced to operate in an online environment. And basically, the primary component here was how to effectively manage their time, okay? How to effectively engage with their peers when it comes to team working, how to, and group working, group work projects, and so on. Okay, the lack of access to the physical facilities, being actually present with their peers inside a physical environment, had a tremendous impact on how the students basically approached their, learning process.
ببین هدفونت سیمیم اونجا بغل میزه، صدای نزیت نکنه.
Okay, sorry. It became also evident that when the students were asked to move from physical model making or producing, in other words, a certain output, let's say, that were previously made with physical materials and so on, and when they were asked basically to design or to produce digital equivalents, the students had huge, if you like, deficiencies or lack of knowledge, in other words, background knowledge on how to address basically this in a digital setting. It was also observed, and this was common basically to all types of modules, that students had really, really poor time management skills. What do I mean by that? And even though that the attendance in a particular content seemed to be really good, the attendance was not a direct function, or it was not directly correlated with the actual engagement in the module. Most of the students typically followed the last minute approach. They did not access the material when they should be accessing during the timetabling hours. Literally, they were accessing and try to engage with the content of the material just before 1 week, even less in some cases, before the deadline of the coursework. That, of course, had a major impact on their performance, and as I said, also at the level of output that was generated during the process. Another very interesting component was the low student engagement, okay, and attendance of additional online content. In many cases, this was something that was very heavily promoted, that academics would provide additional online content, extracurricular, if you like, content for the students to further support their learning and understanding, basically, of the material that is delivered online. In many cases, the greatest percentage of the classes never even accessed this additional material, which basically, to my understanding, shows very low interest in the program that the students are actually attending. They didn't actually take that opportunity to further broaden their horizons and make themselves actually better professionals, if you like, in their own discipline. And as a consequence of all of the above, there were many, many problematic submissions, basically, of the assessment. Last minute submissions, students lower quality of submissions, a lot of have you, I would say, plagiarized content, you know, with the hypothesis that the, let's say, the tutors or the teacher would never find out and so on. So there were many, many problems with the submission, basically, of the assessment that, of course, they were in existence even before, but they became, they were magnified, if you like, during this online delivery of the programs. And of course, necessary consequences, let's say, and actions were taken by academics to ensure that this is not going to become basically a norm. So during this process, and although the data, they look promising in the way that students actually performed in some of the modules, okay, when one looks basically into the details and tries to deconvolute, if you like, the different types of information, let's say, that received, or if you like, averaged at the end of the semester, actually the one can actually see and identify and detect basically a lot of problems that need to be further, if you like, refined and enhanced in the future design of our curriculum and the way that we deliver education basically to our students. One particular skill that I would like to basically focus on, and this has to do basically with the way students in that particular period had, let's say, the opportunity to further strengthen and enhance, was how to handle information by transforming, let's say, our educational mode to an online mode. A vast, I would say, a plethora basically of different resources became available to students. So through online content provision, the student learning autonomy basically was increased. So the students moved towards the direction of independent learning. They became owners basically of their knowledge at a greater degree, but that also was based on how the students access different types of information and on their capacity to screen basically the information that they're receiving from different resources. So for this specific type of research skill, I just use the general term of research skills, basically relates to independent, if you like, learning and lifelong learning skills. And even though the two in some cases are treated separately, to me the form and it's basically two different sides basically of the same coin, because in order to a student to take advantage basically of its of his or her learning autonomy, they should actually be able to develop a real interest in the subject. They should be motivated and they should be committed actually to what they study, and this is basically linked to their also continuous professional development and basically general enhancement of the lifelong learning skills. And once they actually learn how to do that, then they should be able to access the information from different resources, but most importantly, to screen information, to understand what information is actually relevant, and also to be able to interlink information even from seemingly different subjects and make them part of their own applied, if you like, knowledge in a particular project. So this is something that I believe it's one of the most important elements that we have the opportunity through this post-COVID, let's say, education that we provide to the students to improve, in other words, and gradually, let's say, make it an indispensable component of the programs that we deliver and the way that we actually deliver our programs to the students, because this will follow them in the future professional career. And of course, it will become a very valuable asset basically for every kind of company and industry to actually have. This is actually what leads to innovation, creativity, entrepreneurialism, and so on. So just to conclude, I'm not entirely certain for how long actually I have been talking so far. Just some conclusions through this very short study that I had the chance basically to conduct over the past 3 years. It became evident to me basically that there is a strong need for time management skills development for online learning to the students. It was something that literally made me sad, basically, to see the amount of information, the amount of content actually provided to the students, and the complete distance that the student actually took, from this great source of information provided to them, and they more or less, apart from a few exceptions, of course, failed to make it an integral part of their learning, process. Also, digital literacy is something that needs to be to become an integrated, if I like, component of the degree programs, even from the early ages and from the early years of university education, because this will provide the additional flexibility, in other words, for students to be able to react, let's say, and adjust themselves and adjust the way that we approach specific solutions, let's say, to given problems in any kind of industry that they actually find themselves in. Research skills development, it's just exactly what I was describing in the previous slide, and content management, it's something that really became evident to me that it's necessary, because it became evident to me that students are not generally capable of screening the information that they are actually receiving. They are not capable throughout the degree program, in most of the cases, to adjust the information to and the content, basically, that they receive outside their normal curriculum and make it part of an integrated part of their overall, output development. Also, online communication skills that are completely different in comparison to physical, presentation and communication skills, you know, being stuck in front of a screen, giving a presentation as I do now is completely different. And I would completely give differently this presentation if I was live in front of you, able to move my hands as most of the times do. So it's something that needs to become also a part of the modern curriculum design and development. And finally, perhaps the most important has to do with the work-life balance, and which is also linked to lifelong learning skills and continuous development. It became also evident to me, and by talking to some of those students, that the increased learning autonomy that was provided to them in many, many cases actually was detrimental to their learning, simply because on the idea that the content is always accessible, there is still time, you know, to engage with the content and get the coursework done, instead of, you know, actually spending and effectively manage the time throughout the day. Quite a lot of the students moved into, you know, online gaming, for example, considering this online mode of learning is a kind of a big party, in a sense, that the material is always accessible and I still have the time to actually access it and engage with it. And then the reality proved to be very, very different, actually, comparing to the overall output that was produced during the process. So I think that was all that I want to communicate with you. This was basically a self-reflection of what I experienced over the past, 3 years, and I think I was in a good position to witness the change, in the learning attitude and the learning style, of students by moving from online to on-site, from on-site to online, and how also the education institution, how the institution actually reacted and further improved. Okay, the different platforms, the different tools actually that they were, you know, provided to the students and also to the academics to further develop their skills and at the same time more effectively communicate the module content and material and so on. So I think it was a good exercise basically for everyone, and I think everyone became a little bit wiser at the end of it. And I'm certain that this is not going to be something in the past, is something that will remain in the educational culture. Hybrid learning is probably becoming the norm, but at the same time, I feel that there is a lot of work to be done to actually get the students, our students, to the right level to be able to cope with those changes and to be able to be resilient with the shocks that they might experience in their lives. And I think a learning shock of this nature that suddenly becomes from a more systematic, let's say, way of studying physically in the class to a greater, let's say, levels of learning autonomy and how to manage basically their time properly, and which at the end of the day is a kind of a life management skill that that we need to develop. So thank you very much. That's all from my side, and happy to receive any questions or
yes, of any direction. Thank you so much, Dr. Konstantinos. I'm going to facilitate some questions for you. We have actually, if you're pleased to know, about 5 questions to get through, if that's okay with you. Sure. It's definitely been an eye-opener for me to listen to you in regards to the opportunities and also the challenges around digital transformation. It's brilliant. So without further ado, I'm going to take the very first question we received in order of receiving them. So the first question was from our delegate, Shamil Yuruslami, sorry if I've pronounced your name wrong, but the question is, what, according to you, opportunities created COVID-19 pandemic for digital transformation of education system? How technological revolution of remote technologies of COVID and post-COVID era supporting improvement teaching and learning process? Thank you, Shamil.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Samuel. Well, I mean, the cliche, I guess, is when there is a problem, there's always an opportunity. And I believe, being myself, I would say, a huge fan of online learning, I have delivered, for example, what Joanna mentioned at the beginning, my background is mechanical engineering, my research is in chemical engineering, but I think I have managed quite well to deliver, let's say, content and make students enthusiastic in modules and content that is outside of my direct expertise. And the way that I made myself familiar with all of this content and I managed more or less to interlink, if you like, my previous knowledge to the more specialized knowledge in the design field was through online learning. And I think there is a huge opportunity here, basically to, it's not about the content that we deliver, it's not about the amount of information, basically, that we provide to the students, but the real opportunity is actually to train our students to manage their life properly. I think it's something, it's a very difficult, if you like, process for a student only 18, 19, 20 years old that just moved from an educational system that put them in a very rapid assimilation of knowledge and going through, for example, Gaokao system, or if you like national examinations for university entry. And then the student himself or herself perceives this, the university life, to be the fun time. Generally, I think the real opportunity there for learning is to educate our students on how to manage their life, how to manage their time, and how to more holistically, if you like, approach the content that they receive basically in their own discipline and how to link it basically with other disciplines as well. I think this is where the online, the digital, if you like, transformation provides us a big, if you like, arena for improvisation, if you like, and for further creativity, if you like, towards the learning approaches, because now the academics have the opportunity, in other words, to link, if you like, the material that is physically delivered in the class with online material delivered in different disciplines or through different platforms. I can tell you, for example, that it can also, for example, lead to saving costs, basically, in natural, if you like, resources, lab resources, for example. I can tell you, I was delivering last semester a module on, it was called Experimental Methods and Materials and Mechanics, and in addition to the practical activities, I provided a lot of additional content from the fields of biology, for example, from the fields of chemistry, of how these specific techniques can be linked, for example, to different sciences that might not be of direct relevance to what the individual student, let's say, studies, but definitely broadens the horizon, the scope actually of how to approach, let's say, their learning and how to screen and how to analyze information from different fields. I think the real opportunity, if I can say a couple of bullet points here, it would be managing their life and their time, basically. And secondly, accessing, analyzing, being able to analyze and screen, let's say, information that is developed, let's say, in other disciplines as well. This, I think, makes the, if you like, the opens up the mind of individual students and then also enhances their creativity and innovation, because this is usually how innovation works. The ability, basically, to synthesize information from different fields and make them specific to the target, let's say, that or the problem that one has to solve. I think that's the biggest opportunity during this digital transformation education. I'm not sure if this answers the question, but that's at least how I perceive it generally.
Thank you very much. Another question for yourself. It's from Mohammed El Said. Is it all online courses you teach at university? And if not, how does the university manage the lack of face-to-face education and the tendency of students avoiding to go back to classes? Is that something you've experienced?
So, can you please repeat the question? I'm just trying to get the real essence of it. Could you please repeat the question?
Yeah. Is it online courses you teach at university? And if not, how does the university manage the lack of face-to-face education and the tendency of students avoiding to go back to classes? So once they've been online, the return to face-to-face, how has that been managed?
Okay. So yes, first of all, they're all university courses, the ones I'm delivering. And yeah, the second part of the question is actually quite, there have been, it's actually a very nice question. And the reason I'm saying this is because there have been all sorts of different ideas and approaches, basically, of how to deal with students that they do not, in a way, intend to return back to face-to-face education. Of course, it's very, very difficult to police something like that, especially in a period, and during the period, during the COVID period in China, that, you know, different areas might be COVID-free, some other areas might be, you know, under strict, let's say, lockdowns and so on. So there were different types of students attending the same program at the same time, which generated a sense of a sense that students are not required to return back to the class, even though there were groups of students that by university policy should attend the modules on site. Now, if you want my opinion on this, I was personally very relaxed when it came to I would like to give basically the freedom to the students to select the mode of study that they would be willing, let's say, to follow. There are certain elements that need to be physically, let's say, witnessed, especially when it has to do with the practical classes. And typically, students were encouraged and basically, I wouldn't say forced, but it was a part of the whole learning process to physically use, let's say, machines and equipment and so on that are an integral part, let's say, of their learning outcomes. But if you want me to give a more general answer to that, personally, if you want to know my personal view, it doesn't really matter which way a student chooses, basically, to attend, let's say, the different classes. From what I have witnessed, when we have found a way or a formula to generate real interest on the study subject on the student, regardless of the mode of education or of the mode of delivery, the students will engage with the content provided. The key point is, I think, to look back at ourselves as academics. Have we actually provided the right environment for students to learn both physically and digitally in a way? I believe that the majority of academics are not trained enough, including myself, to make full use of this tool, of the digital tools and the available weaponry, let's say, that they have at their disposal to actually cultivate, if you like, or nurture that interest, if you like, on the field, on the students. I think the question is to go back to the academics rather than to the students, because it's something very difficult to create a policy that everyone will follow. Having a student physically in the class while he's sleeping during the delivery doesn't make any difference to me if the student is at home sleeping as well. The point is how we as academics provide the right environment for students to learn physically or digitally. And I think especially on the digital component, there is a lot of progress to be made, a lot of progress to be made.
Thank you. We've got about 3 minutes left, Dr. Konstantinos, so we'll take this last question, and anyone that's outstanding, we'll pick them up a little later, if that's okay, everybody. So this question is from Melissa, who's based in Folkestone in Kent in the UK. She is stating, we are doing hybrid practice for Martello Building Consultancy. Is there a possibility to open online work experience to your students for architecture engineering students as part of the curriculum?
Yes, this is something actually we have been doing with CIOB in any case. So yes. So it's I think it's a simple answer. Basically, yes, there is an opportunity, and I'm not entirely certain if I can provide any details here, but definitely we have the capacity and the structure, the regulatory structure, if you like, in the university to accommodate something like that. Yes. So yes, the simple answer is yes.
Fabulous. Well, we'll take one last question, then we've got 2 minutes left. So the concept, this question is from Tabarak Bilal. The concept of disruptive thinking in teaching and learning is exciting and interesting. Konstantinos, what do you think the challenge are in creating or forging interdisciplinary education across different design disciplines?
Very, very nice question, actually. And this, to me, leads to something that we have been discussing in the school management team over the past year, more or less, about how do we develop or we strengthen, let's say, this sense of community, basically, to the students, and to basically break, let's say, the boundaries of the individual disciplines, and what are the supporting mechanisms, basically, to facilitate that. This is basically something that once achieved, okay, through individual, for example, research projects or specific academics, or through projects that are supported by the school that further extend basically to the individual curriculum as part of studio-based projects or engineering-based projects or even final year project and dissertations, they can become a very nice platform in a way to bring students together in real cross-discipline collaborative research. Just to give you an idea on what we have been working, we call it the Schwanta project in our school. It's basically an urban regeneration project in downtown Suzhou, which is primarily driven by the Department of Architecture and Urban Planning Department. However, through several rounds of competitions, through several rounds of early exhibitions to demonstrate the student output, further students from the engineering discipline and industrial design in terms of local, if you like, clothing and fabrics, as well as rehabilitation of statically deficient, let's say, buildings and so on, came into the picture. So gradually, from a school level supported project, research project with the government, we have managed in a way, at a small scale, which gradually expands to bring students from different disciplines all together. And I think this is actually very important, because it really broadens the horizon of the students. They understand how different disciplines actually work, and disruptive technologies like 3D printing, for example, can come into the picture and in a way modernize, let's say, local crafts and so on, and also engage with the local community and get their opinion and go back and refine the design and so on. I think it's a very nice project. It is very challenging, however, and it needs patience. Nothing can be done overnight. This is a clear message to my team and my students, that we need to work patiently together, and step by step, we will build this tradition and culture within the school. Of course, this has to be also linked to the learning and teaching and research strategy of each individual unit within the school, and also to have the support mechanism to do that in terms of funding, people allocation, and so on. I can talk about this actually for quite a long time because it's something that I have been working on with my team there, but I know we have limited time, but that's a very, very nice question, very interesting. And sometimes very difficult to actually realize and materialize in a sense.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Dr. Konstantinos. It's actually come to an end now, our speaking session. Really pleased that you're here. It's been amazingly very interesting. There's been an array of questions, as you'll agree. Everyone's interested as well. There are a few questions we haven't addressed. If you would take some time to look at those and maybe respond if you can, that'd be fantastic. I'm now going to hand over to Dr. Tabarak Bilal from University of Reading, who will be introducing and facilitating our next speaker. So without further ado, over to Dr. Tabarak, please. Thank you so much. Thank you, Konstantinos. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much, Hassana, and welcome everyone, and thank you very much for joining us today. We are very excited to have you here because this is an opportunity for us to learn from each other and grow together. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Tabarak Bilal. I am a professor of construction engineering and management at the School of the Built Environment within the University of Reading in the UK, and I am going to be your moderator for this session. So I would like, first of all, to introduce our guest speakers. We have a group of researchers from the School of the Built Environment, University of New South Wales in Sydney, Australia. And the speakers are Cynthia Changjiang Wang, Risa Yusia Sanindido, and Samuel Frimpong. So Cynthia is a senior lecturer within the School of the Built Environment, as I said, from the University of New South Wales in Australia. Risa is an associate professor within the same school, and Samuel is a postgraduate researcher in construction management in the same school. I want to thank our speakers for taking the time to share their knowledge and giving us real life examples. The topic is promoting positive mental health among young construction workers from the Global South. And we're really excited to share what we know with you. And this session will focus on promoting an understanding of positive mental health and how it can be facilitated among young construction workers. We'll also take questions at the end of the session, so do please feel free to type them into the chat box. Without further ado, let's start, and I hand over to Cynthia, Risa, and Samuel.
Thank you very much the introduction. Let me share my screen.
Konstantinos, if you don't mind, could you please unshare? Thank you.
Okay, so I was asked to prepare the presentation as a poster. So I have just one item on which we have to focus. And so as you heard, the topic is on promoting the positive mental health of young construction workers from the Global South. And I was supposed to be here with Cynthia and Risa, but unfortunately, because of the time difference, they have asked that I take it here. They have to attend to other things. It's quite late in Sydney, but don't worry, you'll be fine. So a little background to what this whole research has been about. It's something that we've been following for, I think, since 2015. And the main study site has been in Ghana. And it's a country that has many young people and unemployment is an issue. So at the point, the government looked at strategies to deal with youth unemployment in this country. And they saw that two industries could be used to tackle this problem. The first was agric, and then the second was construction, because the barriers to entry into these industries are very low, and then it's something that many young people can readily find employment in. So along the line, a suggestion came up to assess the impacts of the training programs on these young people as far as their health and safety was concerned. And that is when we were invited to come and assess the issue of health and safety on the development programs. Actually, it's a program that targeted over 40,000 young people, and the primary target group was young females, although because construction is largely like dominated by males, there was no way they could have gotten over 40,000 young people without including males. So we looked at both male and female participants in the industry. And during the process of interacting with these young people for over 5 years, we were asked to assess their mental health as well as their physical health. But then we started observing that anytime the topic of mental health came up, the discussion drifted towards disease. And the conception of mental health among this group was largely about depression, anxiety, and another range of mental health disorders. And even when we're looking for tools to assess their mental health status, most of the stuff we were getting was really like measuring disease. And we started thinking, why is it that mental health triggers discussions about disease? Could something be done about it? So that was one of the things that moved us to broaden our study further. And when we started reviewing the literature on mental health, we found out that we were actually up to something very important, because it's well established that construction has a very negative impact on the mental health of people who work in the construction industry. But then when you start looking at studies that have been done, especially in Australia and then in the UK, most of the studies on mental health in the construction industry originate from Australia and the UK, you find out that it's established that although the entire workforce is at risk, young people in particular have an abnormal level of mental health risk. And they have almost double the prevalence. For example, when you take an issue like drug use or alcohol abuse in the industry, which is classified as a mental health issue, you will find out that the risk of young construction workers, that is from a global South perspective, we are looking at those who are less than 35 years. We see that it's double the size of the prevalence for the general population. And that is alarming. Suicide rates in the construction industry are almost double that of other industries. Recently, institutions in Australia have found out that with the aggressive campaign on mental health education and the risk of suicide, the suicide rates in the industry are beginning to show signs of decrease. But the result is the reverse for young people in the industry. So it's actually a big issue that has to be looked at. So the literature shows that these mental health issues and challenges that young people experience are caused by things called psychosocial risk. These are the social and psychological factors that affect every one of us. Examples include, for example, if your financial situation is not good, it sends you thinking. If, for example, you have challenges with people at your workplace, all those are psychosocial risks. So the first thing was to look at what kind of psychosocial risks that young people are exposed to. What is unique to the young people in the construction industry as far as these risks are concerned? And then when you take any particular research that has been done in the construction industry, we found out that there was a pattern. Any research that talks about mental health also tries to investigate disease. We wanted to find out why. And we were surprised that as we did the literature review, we found that there was no particular study that had looked at the issue of positive mental health. So we wanted to understand what that concept really is. So it's part of our research questions: what is positive mental health? And what are the key risks that affect young construction workers? And then how do young construction workers respond when they are at the workplace and then they are exposed to these key risks? So we put in a number of keywords like anxiety, depression, stress, mental health, well-being, and then we received a number of search results. And then when we screened, eventually we were able to narrow down to 237 studies. And those that focus specifically on people under the age of 35 in the construction industry were 32. So we looked through and then were able to identify quite a number of factors that expose young construction workers to poor mental health. And then we also found some that talked about aspects of positive mental health. Now, when I say positive mental health, I mean things that are the opposite of disease, but that have got to do with mental health issues. I'll delve into it as the discussion unfolds. So what we did was that we wanted to overcome a certain challenge when we were observing the young people over the 5-year period. All the instruments that we used to assess their mental health, even the kind of questions that we asked, most of them were foreign to them. For example, the concept of anxiety or depression. When you meet someone in Ghana, I don't know if it's the same with the other African countries or the other countries in the global south or developing countries, but it's very difficult to find a local language that captures depression, anxiety, schizophrenia. So you have to explain and explain and explain and explain until you're able to create a scenario where these young people understand what you mean. So we wanted to overcome that problem in our data collection. So what we did was that the information that we received from the literature review, we put it to these young people. For example, what kind of factors affect you when you are at the workplace? How do you term this? When you feel this way, how do you interpret it? So that we could create questionnaires that are reflective of the setting in which we are collecting our data. We did 16 interviews. Some of those people that we interviewed were young construction workers themselves, because that's the way to go from our perspective. And then we also spoke to employers. And then we spoke to family members of these young construction workers. We spoke to some of their friends. We also spoke to health professionals. And we even spoke to people who are like religious people, because in the setting in which we were collecting the data, most of them were seeking help from these kind of people. After we got all the information on the psychosocial risk or the risk factors, and then we also got information on what they think positive mental health is, we formed two focus groups. So this time we put together 8 people. There were experts there. Some of them were researchers, some young construction workers, some family members, to reflect the social setting in which these construction workers work. And then the question that we put to them was that when we say positive mental health, what does it mean to you? Because we want to understand it from your perspective. So after 2 rounds of focus groups, we went back and then started analyzing the data. The first attention that we gave to the data was to identify what the mental health risks. We found out that there were 3 main groups. There were personal risks, and then there were those that were situated around the organization or the kind of work or the industry in which young construction workers found themselves. And then we also identified socioeconomic risks. So some of the personal risks include having a pre-existing health condition. It could be like when you have problems with your bones and your muscles or general weaknesses in your body. Even being young was a risk for them, because many of them mentioned that because they are young, they are not respected at the workplace. And because they are also young, when they go through a lot of suffering, the people in the society where they live minimize the challenges they have. Some told us that anytime they complain they have issues, their family members will tell them that when you are young, you don't have any problems. Some also mentioned that they feel a sense of inferiority when they go to work, and then they find out because they have low education, when they meet people from the university or other places where they have undergone high skill training, they feel those of them who have not had so much education have a sense of inferiority, and it caused them a lot of distress. The organizational and industrial risk were the nature of the work they were doing. So the issue was with the physically demanding nature of work, And then in the work context as well. So the work environment wasn't good for them. And then a key one was the industry and sociocultural norms. These represent certain practices that are openly or not openly approved in the construction industry. A typical example is the use of drugs and alcohol to deal with difficulties. And then also how for the women especially, the issue was how the males in the industry viewed them. One, for example, told us that she was learning how to be a painter, and then the guys on the site would be telling her, "Are you doing this work because you are hungry?" And then she would get upset because, I mean, it made her feel that she didn't belong, right? Because they were asking her, what would a woman be doing in this kind of industry trying to learn how to paint? You should be somewhere else. And those kinds of display of masculinity was something that affected some of the women as well. And some of the women were also expected to demonstrate very tough behavior to be accepted in the industry, which was contrary to how they felt they were. And then there were also socioeconomic issues, which had got to do with social circumstances. For example, the kind of family background the construction workers came from, and then family setup. If they had a child, for the females especially, concerns about child care. If they had to choose between staying home to take care of a child and then going to the construction site to work. Where these young women did not have partners who were supportive, it meant that staying home to take care of their child will be to forego their source of livelihood, and then that exacerbated their financial situation. And there were also economic circumstances, especially finding a job and then wondering if the project ended, where the next job was going to come from. The next set of issues that we looked at was the coping strategies. Practically, how do young people deal with these challenges that come when they are on the construction sites? We saw three main types of coping: problem-focused, emotion-focused, and then the third one was maladaptive, which is not captured here. So problem-focused coping specifically talks about the kind of strategies that are adopted to solve problems when they show up. So one was active coping, meaning that if, for example, they face bullying on site, they can take specific steps like reporting to the supervisor. They deal with the problem itself. And then also instrumental social support, they also trying to seek help from social groups. So sometimes they would form groups to learn about the challenges they are facing, sometimes just even to discuss the problems that they have on site. And then the second set was emotion-focused coping. This one specifically does not target the problem, but rather targets how someone feels about the problem. So talking to your friend about something that makes you feel bad, just so that you have a listening ear. And then going to church, praying, talking to a religious leader, seeking comfort from other people. That was used a lot. And then for more adaptive, there were mainly four types: drug and alcohol use. And we saw that this was most prevalent because it was something that most of them had to do to be accepted as part of the workforce. It showed that you are masculine enough, even though they felt that it wasn't good for them. And then some would also cope by staying away from work. And in the case of some who were apprentices, they would just opt out of the training that they were receiving from the master craftsmen. And then others also coped by being very aggressive toward their colleagues at work. Now we come to the issue of positive mental health. So this is what it means. According to the theory, every individual has mental health. There's a negative component and then there's a positive component. So for example, when you are told that you are going to be sacked from work, or you are going to be dismissed, or you will lose your job and then you will not get it back, you go through a certain phase. You can go through some level of anxiety or depression. That is a negative aspect of mental health. And then when you are told that you have been promoted, you go through a certain phase of mental health. That is positive. So we wanted to find out what positive mental health means to this group. So we asked them, when you feel that your mental health is good, what are some of the things you do? What are some of the emotions that you experience? And after we sorted out the data, we were able to break it down into four key components. The first one was emotional health. This one basically talks about good feelings, about self, and then health. So, for example, when they go to work and then they are able to deliver exactly what they were told to do, they feel good. That means that they are functioning well at the workplace. And then another set was psychological health. This time, it's not just a matter of good feeling, but a sense of personal progress. So as someone works as an apprentice and then they are promoted to a master craftsman, they feel that they are making progress in their lives personally for themselves. Or for example, if they build a certain, if they are working on a particular project, for example, these young people at the end of the training program, they were sent to say a school in the community, and then they were asked to propose changes to be done to that school. Some were actually asked to undertake a repair project. As they worked on these kind of projects, some felt that they had gained valuable skills that helped them to increase in their professional capacity as construction workers. That is a sense of psychological health. And then we found social health. This one is more of progress in their society. So how do you relate with your colleagues at work? Do you feel that you are a valuable member of the society? And things like that. The kind of rules that are at the workplace, do they make a lot of sense to you? And when you go back to the literature, because this was a purely qualitative study, we went back to the literature, we read and saw whether there were frameworks that we could use to fit the data we are finding. And then we found out that mostly, like, measuring positive mental health was looked at as something that was emotional, psychological, and then social. So we wanted to end there. But after sorting the data, we found extra categories of information that could not fit all three. So we started looking at them. For example, a lot of the young people attributed their success in the industry to God. Some also felt that there were supernatural things that were behind their success. There was something that worried them. And then others also felt that their work was impeding their ability to perhaps go to church, especially if we met people who were Muslims on the site. They needed to be able to pray a certain number of times in a day. So if they were on a site where the supervisor or the company policy did not allow that, they felt a bit distressed. Whereas if they were on a site where they had the freedom to be able to practice these aspects of their godly devotion, they felt happier. So we looked at it and then we conceptualized all of that as spiritual health.
Samuel?
Yeah,
my time. We're quickly running out of time. Are you able to round up very quickly? Yes. Or we could, yes, of course, expand on this in the afternoon session. So if you could wrap up very quickly this session, and then we'll take questions in the afternoon.
Okay, so I'll do that in just 1 minute. So propose a model between the mental health risks, the coping strategies, and positive mental health. Now, this is important because it's established that when people are able to increase their positive mental health, automatically it reduces symptoms of negative mental health. So instead of trying to help people to achieve well-being by eliminating depression, anxiety, we could begin to do research that focuses on how we can increase the positive mental health of young people. Now, the identification of spiritual health is also important because it adds to existing ways that we try to measure positive mental health. Currently, we do so without considering spiritual health, but our findings suggest that this could be an important key, especially for people who have a sense of spirituality and religion, and majority of the world's population fall in that category, especially the young people from the global south. So we are looking to do more collaboration on these studies. If you are interested, you could send us information, or you could email us for further discussions on this particular issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Samuel. That was very, very interesting. Hopefully we'll take some questions later in the afternoon. Our session is coming to an end, and I would like to hand over now to Teddy, who will be joined by Whitney, Bevan and Ashley McCurry on the next session. Thank you very much. Over to you, Teddy. Teddy, are you with us? Or maybe I should hand back to Hasna.
Thank you very much, Samuel, for such a delightful presentation. Good day, all. I am Lord Teddy, who like the education liaison with JAFCD. I join you all today. I join you all today from South Africa, and it is a great pleasure to be with you all on our very first CIOB Academic Summit. I'm certain that we've enjoyed our very first two sessions. So please send a wave on our chat box if you'd like to. I'm now pleased to welcome our next guest contributors, Dr. Whitney Bevan, who is a lecturer in construction management at the Scott Sutherland School of Architecture and Built Environment at the Robert Gordon University. Whitney is motivated to creating an environment where students are encouraged to be innovative, creative in their thinking, and are curious as to how the classroom theory works in practice, and have the opportunity to discover what ignites their passion within the built environment. Whitney's enthusiasm and promotion in the well-being extends beyond her working hours, as she is a keen ultra runner, a fitness instructor, and a nutritional health coach. Co-delivering this session today, we are joined by Ashley McCurry, who currently works as an assistant quantity surveyor at McGowan Environmental Engineering Ltd. It is a civil environmental engineering company based in Aviemore, Scotland. Whilst working full-time for McGowan, Ashley has been undertaking a graduate apprenticeship in construction and the built environment with Robert Gordon since 2019. And I believe you graduated in 2020, Ashley. So congratulations to you, 2022. And to our audience, you can expect the next 45 minutes to learn more about the adoption of sustainable practices in small to medium enterprises, SMMEs. So please help me welcome Dr. Whitney Bevan and Ashley McCurry. Over to you.
Hello, good morning. Thank you so much, Teddy, for the introduction, and Teddy and Asana for organising this conference and everything in the background. Good morning, I'm Whitney Bevan from Robert Gordon University, and we'll be talking to you about sustainable practice and their adoption in small to medium enterprise. I'm just going to get my slides up. Set them on. Okay, hopefully you can see that. Teddy, let me know if you cannot.
Yes, you can.
Oh, amazing. Thank you. We'll be talking about the adoption of sustainable practices, small to medium enterprises within the UK construction industry, and just a bit of background from me. So Ashley is one of my GA students, and this was some research undertaken, or some really great piece of research undertaken for her dissertation. Probably from my side, sustainability is my field of research, sustainability within construction, and also how sustainability is being embedded within construction, or how, you know, the construction industry within organizations, how they're actually undertaking, maybe meeting a sustainable strategy or maybe meeting their agenda. That's my area of research. So obviously I was delighted to help Ashley as supervisor, but also go through her first bit of research. Ashley, over to you.
Thank you, Whitney. I'm a quantity surveyor. I started, just a bit of a background about me, I started in the construction industry as a project admin on a complex engineering project, and I developed into that into a trainee project manager, and then went on to focus more on a commercial role as a quantity surveyor. During that time, I undertook a four-year graduate apprenticeship with Robert Gordon's University, and in my final year, I undertook this research into the adoption of sustainable practices within small to medium enterprises, in construction companies, sorry. That was sort of my background, and that was what was driving this research. So today, we're going to give you an introduction to the adoption of sustainable practices, identify the problem currently faced within the industry, and then the aim of the research as well. So it'll provide an overview of what the literature tells us currently, the research methods utilised, and then what the research findings and recommendations were, and then finishing up with further areas of research. So a bit about the introduction and the background. So the United Nations Agenda for 2030 for Sustainable Development seeks to address a wide range of current and future challenges facing the planet, people and prosperity, combining the environment, social and economic sustainability to give the 17 Sustainability Development Goals. The UK being one of 193 countries who have pledged their dedication to achieving the UN Sustainability Goals by integrating them into the national policies and legislation. For example, the UK have updated a number of legislations around the Build Back Better strategy to achieve net zero emissions, enhance air quality and reduce waste. Focus then turns to the construction industry and industries in general to act in accordance with this new legislation to ensure the UK achieve their commitment. So the problem. The pressure placed on the construction industry to incorporate sustainable practices is within many new legislation. However, there is concern regarding the lack of engagement by SMEs to incorporate sustainable practices and the challenges that they are faced with in doing so. SMEs provide a significant contribution to the social, economic and environmental impact, and therefore the UK government will likely fail to achieve their government targets on sustainability without the involvement of SMEs. So the literature suggests that the lack of engagement could be as a result of multiple ideas of sustainability and what sustainable practices are, a reluctance by SMEs to engage with sustainable practices, and a limited insight into what SMEs are doing to implement sustainable practices. So the aim of this research was to explore sustainable practices and their adoption in SMEs, understand the barriers faced by SMEs, and to allow recommendations to assist SMEs in adopting sustainable practice to comply with government legislation. So the next slide, I think, is on our literature. Whitney.
Yes, yeah, that's me. Thank you so much, Ash, for introducing the problem and the aims of the research. In terms of the literature, just similar to sustainability, it's quite a broad topic in terms of what sustainable practice or sustainable construction practice or sustainable practices actually means. Just like we have our different definitions of sustainability, they have this you know, a wide range of definitions of what sustainable practices actually are. Just similar to sustainability, there is that element of environment, social and economic.
On you made it.
Have we got a mute, please? Thank you. Whitney, you're muted now, Whitney. Please unmute yourself and Ashley.
Okay, sorry. I'll start again with the literature. So in terms of the literature, quite a big broad definition of sustainable practices, sustainable construction practices, just like we have with sustainability. So it seems to be open to interpretation in terms of what one organisation say sustainable practices actually are, and also previous investigations of what they say sustainable practices actually are. I think the big thing for me, what's really interesting, there's lots in terms of what we need to gain, what we need to do in terms of we need to be implementing sustainable practices, we need to be doing this, we need to be doing that. But it's very little in terms of that advice for how to do it. So what is the actual actions we need to do if we're going to adopt sustainable practices in organisations? And I think that how is needed for, you know, for that transparency in terms of what works, what doesn't work. So, you know, in terms of our SMEs, you know, they're the largest part of the construction sector. And just like Ashley said, if we are going to try and meet our sustainable development goals, we need to be making sure that they are on board with implementing sustainable practice, but also we need to give, they need some advice and help in terms of how to actually do that. Again, a big portion of the literature on sustainable practice talks about the barriers to why they can't be done, or what organisations are finding are the issues with it. And this is such a big range of the literature, as well as that definition of what sustainable practices actually are. And there was a few barriers throughout the literature. There's that lack of knowledge, lack of understanding of sustainable practices. And with such a broad definition and various people have different ideas, you know, there's no wonder there's a lack of understanding, maybe confusion. Lack of awareness of the impact and benefits. You know, as we know that if sustainable practices are done correctly and the appropriate ones are chosen, that there are those benefits for the organisation, as well as, you know, the planet, as well as the social impacts. Lack of time and resources is also a big one. There's an assumption that when, you know, you need to implement these sustainable practices, there will be, you know, you'll need to be have more time spent, more resources spent. So that is often, you know, a barrier. And there's ways in which you want to think what the priorities are. And obviously the priorities are, you know, working as a business, you know, making profit, etc. So I think that is a question that maybe organizations are asking themselves. Well, how much more is it going to cost? What else am I going to need to do? Will it take the time of my workforce, etc.? Lack of skills and expertise. So what skills people need in order to implement some of the sustainable practices, and do we have them in our workforce, or do we need to outsource? Again, that will be time and resources. The risk of adopting new practices. So again, what would happen? What would be the challenge, and what would be the risk to my organization? Again, things like time, money, but also there's a very small proportion of risk that don't adopt sustainable practices within the literature as well. And then organizational culture. That is also a big topic. And I also think that topic and those themes underlie a lot of the work, because it does start with that culture within organization, you know, with the perceptions and understanding and awareness and thoughts on sustainable practices. If that culture is embedded, that, you know, that's an add-in, not an add-on, it's not an extra, it's not an optional. If we do it, it will help with our business, etc. So I think that culture is really important, possibly from the top down within the organization. So you'll see that, like I mentioned, with that such a wide-ranging definition, including so many different things, just like we've seen here, you can see in this bottom quote, in that it is social, economic, environmental, but also then above it, they also add resilience as well. So there's many different themes that come out of what sustainable practices are and what it can offer to an organization. So again, I think if you talk to different organizations or you see what different organizations are doing, they might be having different ideas of what sustainable practices are or what they encompass. And if we're talking about sustainable practices, these were just some of the themes that came out of the literature in what people associate with sustainable practices. Time and resources is a big one, and also a big one for SMEs. They have fewer employees than, you know, our larger companies. So there's more concern over your resources within the company. Skills and expertise and risk. There's a lot of concern over greenwash. And, you know, that is where we might be unsure about some of the terms that we're using. I think that's also related a lot to awareness as well. So it's thinking about what that risk would be. Should I invest in these sustainable practices? What my priorities are? but also thinking about that risk that if I don't do it. And then organizational culture. I think this also comes into where we talk about, you know, sustainability and, you know, sustainable practices, where we think about it's sort of out of our hands. There's less of maybe an ownership on it, or an empowerment that SMEs or the individual, you know, can my contribution help with, you know, the broader climate change agenda or the broader sustainability agenda. So I think that it's quite easy to say that, well, you know, we're such a small company, we can't really make a big impact. And I think that's what they talk about in the literature, that there is a need to embed that culture that is more optimistic and more empowering, and ownership and thinking about what can be done here, and that, you know, it is embedded within our organisation and within our practices. Rather, it is going to be, rather it isn't going to be, you know, that negativity. So that is probably in a nutshell the literature. There's a lot on sustainable practices, what they are, what are the ideas associated with sustainable practices, and a lot on the barriers and how, you know, people have maybe not adopted them because of these different things, but not a lot in terms of how to overcome the barriers, but also those actual methods that, I don't know if anything like me, I need to have that this is what can be done, or this is what we've done, and this, you know, these were the benefits for us, or these were maybe the challenges for us. And I think that is probably a bit more of that is needed within the literature. Ashley, over to you.
Sorry, I was on mute there. So the research methods, the methods that I'd undertaken was an interpretivist approach. This was appropriate in that, like Whitney was saying, that many companies have different experiences, knowledge, and understanding of what sustainable practices are. And therefore, having this approach to the research was meant that I could gain an understanding of the perceptions. Again, the qualitative data was key in this research, as I wanted that in-depth response from SMEs and companies and the supply chains that all serve into this, rather than a quantitative study would have given me. I also utilised both primary and secondary data. Primary data was undertaken via an interview with a CEO of an SME, while secondary data was collected from literature sources, so journals, books, and also the organisational reports that I gathered from the case studies that I'd undertaken. So I undertook a case study approach, looking at a larger company and its approach to sustainable practices, and an SME and its approach to sustainable practices and where they were at in that one. Ethics. So Robert Gordon's university has a strict ethical procedures, and these were complied with throughout the research. So I sought and obtained signed consent forms, which I've shown at the side there, from a participant of the interview, and ensured that they were fully informed throughout the process. And then also I sent the interview protocol and consent forms over to Whitney, my research supervisor, to ensure that everything was undertaken appropriately. Okay, so the results. So the both cases that I looked at, the larger company and the case study B, the SME demonstrated an engagement with sustainable practices. So it wasn't like the larger company, they had the resource, they had the time, they had the money, they were showing all signs of being compliant with the adoption of sustainable practices, whereas an SME didn't. This wasn't the case, which was sort of coming out within the literature. This SME did demonstrate that they were aware of sustainable practices, they wanted to make a difference within their company and comply with what their stakeholders were looking for. So whilst case study A referred to the UN SDGs, case we made one of a reference to which was a reference to the larger company. That was sorry, I'll start that again. So case A directly referred to sustainability goals within their sustainability policies and procedures, whilst case B made more of a reference to a company driven values and beliefs and approaches to sustainability, and that was driven from management, and it was all about the economic sustainability and finding a balance between the social, economic and the environmental sustainability. Case B had more of a focus towards environmental and social sustainability, so community involvement and legacy, as well as construction methods to be sustainable through that way. So if we look further into the results of case study, of both case studies, so case study A, so sustainable practices were adopted from three key areas, which was a focus focusing within the business. So these were aligned and applicable to the appropriate United Nations sustainability goals. There was then targets sent against these three areas to measure and monitor their compliance with these. However, although they had these sustainable practices adopted, they were facing barriers as well. So they had financial barriers, technological infrastructure, and their supply chain was a huge one. What they focused on as a barrier. Recommendation. So whilst I looked at the barriers and within case study A, there was recommendations that they were coming through to help develop their company. So they were looking at financial incentives and customer funding, clearer routes for low carbon approaches and government support for SMEs within their supply chain. Whilst case study B, their sustainable practices adopted were key to the organizational functions. So that's quite an important point. They looked specifically at their business functions and tried to select ones that were specific to what they were doing, as opposed to trying looking at what legislation was telling them, meeting these targets. They were trying to focus in on that stuff that they could make a difference straight away. But it was driven by internal values and the owner of the company, and then that transferred into the management and also through communication through to employees at all levels. So everybody was on the same page. Everybody was aware what they were, what the company was aiming for to achieve their sustainable practices. Being a SME, there was a key focus on their local community. They were obviously employed a lot of people from the immediate community, and that it was about building this legacy for everyone within the community that the company was based. So there was that responsibility and that, again, coming in from internal values and beliefs of the people within the company. However, there were barriers faced, obviously, being an SME. And these were highlighted within the literature that were then acknowledged within the case study that I undertook. So the main barriers were resource. Like Whitney was saying previously, within the literature, it was resource. A lot of employees within SMEs already have multiple responsibilities that a larger corporation within the same job role might not have. So that was the resource that already have a lot of responsibility already to then undertake something new, like a sustainable practice or maybe a different method of working. So that was a key barrier. There was also the financial risk for it. One of the findings was from this case study was that they were trying to find the balance between not solely focusing on environmental or social, because that jeopardized their economic return for the company. So it was finding that balance between them and then obviously the risk of undertaking a sustainable practice that then might not pay off economically to them in the short term, but maybe might have a longer term gain. So it was finding that balance for the financial as well. Knowledge and awareness. Whilst there was a sustainable practice being adopted, the knowledge, full knowledge of what that sustainable practice could lead to or could develop into throughout the whole management team, maybe wasn't, there was varying different levels basically of knowledge and awareness. And then compliance with government legislation. So this was actually coming out as a barrier. There wasn't, the government is placing these legislations in for everybody to obtain to, but there's not necessarily stepping stones, or like Whitney was saying before, the how to, how do we be compliant within an SME? we want to adopt these sustainable practices, but we don't know how. So it's getting that is being what is considered as a barrier to try and be compliant, but there's no how to for that one. So the findings, contrasting to the literature, both cases showed an understanding of the benefits of sustainable practices, but again, it's the how to. So there was examples of adding value to the community and the environment, both within case study A, as well as recognising the value that adopting sustainable practices would have to the company within case study B. Additional sustainable practices were identified that were not already present within the literature. So these included the integration of sustainable construction. So previously, I think I mentioned or touched upon the construction methods the company B chose to undertake to ensure that they could increase biodiversity within their projects through their construction methods, and then also the pollution prevention, where that might vary between company and company on how they undertake, because there is maybe a time element to certain things of how they undertake the construction. Also the renewables within projects. So within case study B, they were identifying projects that had a positive effect on the environment and weren't necessarily undertaking projects that maybe had a more of a detrimental effect on the environment or the social and economic surrounding that project. So those were new ones that were added in there. Some of the key similarities and differences on the barrier as identified from the research. So just talking a bit more about that. So yeah, the literature identified lack of awareness, but it might not be that it's the awareness, we're all aware of it, but it's more the understanding, the more skills and need for training on sustainable practices, and more of a defined definition of sustainable practices maybe required for each SMEs, what that means to them, lack of time, which again comes into the lack of resource, time and resource, we're needing that additional support, and then again training. Infrastructure was identified as a new barrier, having things in place that makes it easier for SMEs to work towards. Legislation was a new barrier identified, which wasn't flagged up within the literature. A lack of government intervention as well for SMEs. And supply chain integration and sustainable practices, and then technological barriers as well that were being faced more within the supply chains of larger companies, i.e. SMEs. So those were sort of new ones. So the research recommendations was a big driver of why I sort of wanted to undertake this research, wanted to try and try to identify the how-to, which wasn't coming apparent within the existing literature. So the recommendations to overcome barriers, financial incentives, either through the client or stakeholder for an SME, or coming from further up from government to provide that initial incentive to promote the adoption of sustainable practices that are specific to SMEs. Clearer routes for low carbon approaches, materials and innovations. So there is a wealth of knowledge out there to go seek for reducing carbon emissions, but might not always be apparent to SMEs. So a clearer route for what they can do, making it more apparent and then more approachable for us SMEs to undertake these low carbon reduction. More government support to encourage adoption of sustainable practice by SMEs. So yeah, I think this is a big one. Obviously, you've got the legislation there, but how do we do that? How do we get there? And then knowledge shared by key stakeholders. So it's having that what a larger company is looking for. What are they undertaking sustainability wise, sustainable practices, and how they can assist their supply chain who are ultimately SMEs to build on that, and it has an open dialogue with them. It's also quite strategic for SMEs to do that so that they can have almost a building block to build on what are their key stakeholders looking for and what can they do to assist. And then we've got some recommendations for the adoption of sustainable practices by SMEs. So what can they do? Looking at both the larger company case study A and then the smaller company case study B, it was apparent that the management team could review their core business functions and level of knowledge to understand sustainable practices and take actions on that. So seek training, seek what it is that their core business functions are and see if there's an alternative, a sustainable alternative to what they're doing, and keep it quite specific to what their core business functions are, rather than try to look at the bigger picture almost at once, but starting off what their business functions are. SMEs to, again, SMEs to open up a dialogue with key stakeholders to gain insight and knowledge share. So that is, like I was saying before, that's it would be quite strategic to do that for an SME who is thinking, it's going to cost too much, it's going to do this, it's risky, and we don't have the time. Having that initial dialogue with a stakeholder is just that knowledge share. What are they looking for? What could we do to assist that? And then integrate that into adopt that as a sustainable practice. Also looking at connecting the adoption of sustainable practice to the wider United Nations sustainability goals, and then adapting that to what the local challenges are faced within that surrounding that SME. And so that might help to monitor and measure compliance with whatever adopted sustainable practice that SME is taking. And then top management commitment. I think that this is quite a big one. Again, it comes back to that organizational culture, that top management commitment to sustainable practices, setting targets to achieve in that throughout all manager through the whole one.
Thanks, Ash. So further areas of research, I think it would be beneficial to interview another SME. I think it'd be good to see if there's a similarity between the other SME that, or the SME that Ash looked at, we looked at. I think that we talk about those findings where that it's sort of bespoke in terms of their sustainable practice and idea is sort of bespoke to that organisation. So thinking as well, they have, because of, you know, they're smaller than the other case, whether that would be bespoke and thinking about, you know, how they adopt sustainable practice and sustainable practice definition. I think it'd be really important to ask, because of you're not going to have, it's unlikely that you're going to have every sustainable practice going to be appropriate to every organisation. Every organisation is different, workforce is different, skills are different, you know, where they are is different, what they do is different. So it'd be good to get that perception as well from them. Ask why these barriers, you know, get the detail on the barriers, get some examples of barriers. So if it's time and resources, where is that going? And also I think a lot of it when we talk about is a lot of perception, but you know, having those examples will actually help to explain and, you know, have that explanation really pan out so we can see where those challenges are. And like we've talked about throughout, examples of sustainable practice, where it has worked, where it hasn't. Ash also spoke about in the results of where the company, the SME, thought about having that balance between environment, social and economic. And I think that is, you know, essential to the adoption of sustainable practices. But how do we do it? And I think that is also a worry that we think we're looking at the environment and the social, the benefits are there, but maybe it's costing too much. Or we're looking just at the environmental, and you know we're not hitting that social one. So thinking of how companies balance that out, and the decisions that go into making the decision of that sustainable practice, I think would really help. Again, how the actions. So what actually happened? What was the communication? Ashley talks a lot about the communication in her results between the different stakeholders. So how, what actually has to happen? I think that, you know, if we see those challenges and the examples in reference to the challenges that maybe SMEs face to overcome and implement sustainable practices and the adoption, we can then foresee it for other companies in the future, and maybe they can then adjust. And then sustainable strategies and sustainable practices, what would be feasible? So understanding the feasibility of it, I think that would help. Again, coming back to the perceptions of it, and thinking about, okay, how would that then work? Maybe bespoke to our organization or this SME. And a lot of it does seem to be perceptions of barriers. So it'd be good to go through the barriers themselves in terms of examples, and then how you overcome those barriers, and the actions that could be taken to adopt in that sustainable practice, meeting that balance. And you know, I think it'd be good to understand which ones work in certain organizations, and you know, which ones actually do face those challenges. I've just put up these two images that for me talk about different types of sustainable practices within organizations, and you know, adding the extras like resilience in terms of an organization and your environment, social and economic. He's talking a little bit about well-being. I'm sure Fred won't mind me stealing that. And also talking about that education. So some of the skills and resources that might need to be used in order to adopt the sustainable practices. We've just got put two pages of our references, and we invite any questions from the audience or comments for further research, or comments on the research. Thank you so much for listening. Eddie, back over to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Whitney and Ashley. I hope you're able to hear me.
Yeah.
Perfect. So thank you so much for delivering such an insightful presentation. We do have some questions and a bit of comments. I also have a few questions I'd like to ask myself, but let's just firstly start with our audience. I'll just be asking them out in no particular order. So the first question I'll be asking is from Hassana, saying, did your research find that perhaps large organizations within the ecosystem could undertake or mitigate the risk associated with supporting SMEs via supply chain privileges?
I think interesting, really interesting question. I think that we didn't find that in our research. I don't know if you did, I should jump in if you did, but I think that you know, could be a possibility. But I think, again, there needs to be that communication with your various stakeholders and shareholders if that's going to happen.
I agree, Whitney. Yeah.
Okay.
We didn't find it. That didn't come out as a result, or we didn't, you know, that didn't really come out of our case A.
Yeah. No, thank you so much we've got more questions coming in. So the next question is from Freeman 2, Sean. Does sustainable practice include the materials used? How much weight is given to this compared to construction methods?
I would think that it would. I think it, as long as it's tailored to that business or that company, then I think that would be considered as a sustainable practice of what materials were used, if it's sustainably sourced. I think it would have a weighting on it. What do you think, Whitney?
Yeah, I would definitely say yes. In terms of it would have, I don't know how much of a weight it would have, but what I would say, just because of, I like to be a bit optimistic, but also careful in talking about that, you know, environmental, social, economic, in that if it doesn't lend itself to that company, and yes, it will be materials in terms of, you know, certification. But for example, if I'm thinking about my materials coming from, I don't know, Aberdeen, if my site's in Aberdeen, or Bournemouth, then yes, I will locate them from Aberdeen if I can. But if that is at the expense of maybe not having the most suitable material, then I'd have to get them from Bournemouth, but you know, I wouldn't have a choice. But maybe I could think about other sustainable practices that would be more urgent than that one. But I'd definitely say it would, you know, in terms of the findings as well, in terms of what people are actually doing, it's about thinking about that material, where it's coming from. Is it, you know, certified sustainable source, for example, timber? And also the type of material. So can it be reused, recycled, etc., further on in your building, in your development?
Okay, thank you for those answers, Ashley and Whitney. I've got another one on our chat box. It's from Akinfala Yetunde, saying, what kind of approach would you advise for a more interpretive knowledge sustainable practice? Because sometimes the lectures given on sustainable practice are not really explicit and can sometimes be confusing.
So we did take an interpretivist approach within our research. I'd say that because sustainable practices, the definition is so broad, but also there's many different sustainable practices. So it's not about being explicit, it's about getting a foundation of understanding what sustainable practices are, and then maybe doing your own research and your own analysis on that individual organization, if we're looking at, you know, putting it to an organization, and with your understanding of the foundations of what it is, then understand of whether it can be applied to that organization. So, you know, it wouldn't be good for me to give a lecture or give a sustainable practice, saying, I don't know, sustainable procurement, and saying, yes, Barrett's and Balfour Beatty can do it this way, both the same. That wouldn't happen. It's about analysing the company, where they are, what they do, how they build, the workforce, etc. But it's also about doing your own research of what sustainable practices actually are and that company as well. But yes, this did take an interpretivist approach to the research itself. But when explaining it, probably needs to get an understanding of foundations first.
Thank you so much for that answer, Whitney. And I'm just checking our chat box, and I actually have a question to ask, which is directly both to you, Whitney, and Ashley. So for someone like me who's recently learning more about, you know, the adoption of sustainable practice in small to medium enterprises, what are some of the best resources, you know, for people who want to dive deeper into such topics?
My knowledge base on this was quite limited when I started this research. So I find that journals were a really good, useful resource to use to get my initial understanding. And then from there, it was picking up who they'd referenced within their journal articles. And then I was kind of almost like a spiral going into seeing what they research they had undertaken and how they'd built that back up. So I did journal articles, yes, they were great. And then also looking at, because I was already within the workplace, looking at my own company and then comparing that to other companies. So it was like larger companies are a good source as well to look at, because they have what their sustainability approaches are within on their websites. So even if you want to look at the journal articles and then look what companies are doing, larger companies are doing, and sort of comparing that and then building up the picture from there. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, I would agree with you, Ashley. But also, I think it's, Ashley's obviously in industry as well, so she can actually ask. I am learning not to ask. So, you know, for example, if I'm talking to a project manager from Balfour Beatty or Barrett's or whoever, I am learning to not say, what are you doing for sustainable practices? Because their version of sustainable practices might not be my version of sustainable practices. And also they might not know that they're doing sustainable practice or they implement or adopt sustainable practices. They might just be meeting targets of the sustainability agenda. So I would say, you know, if you come into contact with companies in your network, I would say, you know, what are you doing for sustainability? Are you adopting sustainability within your organization? You know, does your organization you know, caring about sustainability? Is it within the culture? You know, what kinds of things are you doing maybe every day or monthly targets or whatever? Are you building? What are your buildings like? You know, are they concerned? What are your workforce? Are they thinking about their operational energy? What is it that you're doing? And I think that will unfold in terms of what they mean by sustainable practices, which will be different for everyone. But also that might be further insight into something that I wouldn't have thought of that they've done that's been a real benefit to their company or to meeting that sustainability agenda. So I think the best thing to start with is talking. Sustainable practice is not something that's new, and it doesn't seem new within the literature either, but I think more people have an awareness and understanding of it and are, you know, bespoke to their organisation and their conditions and their characteristics are certainly adopting them. So I think talking and reading, Eddie, would be my advice.
Very insightful and absolutely a great starting point. We have about 3 minutes left, and I see on our comments, it's not a question, but rather a comment from my colleague Ross, saying, if you embed a culture of continuous learning and sharing best practice, it might perhaps change the culture and the way we do things.
Yeah.
So thank you so much, Ross, for sharing that. And thank you all for your undivided attention. And I hope we all equally enjoyed this session. And I'm very delighted to now hand over to my colleague, Ross Thorpe, for our very closing remarks. Once again, thank you very much to our guest speakers, Whitney and Ashley. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Teddy.
Thank you.
Thanks for the questions. And well done, Ashley.
Thank you.
Well done. Well done, both. Excellent. I'm absolutely honoured and delighted to deliver the concluding remarks on what is our first, but definitely won't be our last, CIOB Academic Summit. And I really must thank the team, Hassana and Teddy, for their enthusiasm and dedication in making this work. They've put their heart and soul into this. They're so excited about it. And I'm delighted that we've had such good attendance. I would also like to extend my thanks to all of our speakers and contributors, and these include Joanna Poon, who did such a sterling job on the opening comments and remarks, Konstantinos from Liverpool University, who did a fascinating talk on technology and disruptive teaching and learning methods, as well as the challenges of cross-disciplinary working. I do think that learning actually is as vital to human beings as breathing, eating and drinking. It's something that human beings must do. And so new methods in learning are really important. And I think sharing those learning methodologies across our academic community is vitally important. So thank you to Konstantinos. And thank you very much to Samuel Frimpong, who did a sterling job staying awake late at night to talk to us about the terrible challenges we face in terms of mental health in the industry. And I was shocked by the suicide statistics that he gave, double against other industries. So any tools or methodologies for looking and recognizing those things is vital for our industry. And of course, last but not least, Whitney and Ashley for their fascinating talk on the challenges and opportunities for small to medium sized businesses in adopting sustainable practices. I think that's a really important thing because it's not just sustainability that organizations face difficulties with. It is really their day-to-day survival. So I think much is made of the challenges, but what Ashley and Whitney have done really well is talked about what the opportunities are for those companies, so how they can scale up their organizations and become more agile. Finally, before I let you go for your lunch, which I'm sure you're all very hungry, I wanted to take this opportunity to talk to you about our newly launched Global Student Challenge. Our global student challenge is a team building exercise. It's a real life project. We have a new partner, Centura, who have a dedicated platform. Students work in teams on a real life project, and it really develops those students' skills. It develops their negotiation skills, their decision making skills, their listening skills, their persuasion skills, and cross disciplinary working, of course, as well. So I really would encourage you to have a look at our Global Student Challenge. I'm going to put a link to it in the chat box so that you can offer extra value to your students. It really is an excellent opportunity to work across teams, across different universities and different organisations. So do have a look at that. And finally, just once again, to say thank you to all our delegates who joined us today from across the world, and to wish you either a very good day or a very good night. Thank you very much.